Good morning. Give thanks to God and call upon his name, for God is great and God is here. Spread the news of what God has already done throughout the world, for God is great and God is here. Sing praise and shout for joy, for God is great and God is here. Let us worship God together. Welcome to everybody who's here today, especially any visitors we have. Please take time to sign the friendship pad and to share it with one another and greet each other in the name of Christ. Many announcements in the bulletin, and we have insert. And I'd like to call your attention to the insert on, it's about the learning fair that the Presbytery puts on every year. It's an excellent event. It'll be at the Elizabethtown Presbyterian Church on Saturday, September 19th. There's information and also how you can find the list of workshops. I encourage you to at least look this up and think about it and see what captures your attention. Other things happening in the life of the church can be found in the bulletin and in the announcements. We have 3 minutes for mission today. One about fall faith and fellowship and back to school supplies. There's an announcement about that. And then Pat Barrow with the summer reading program. But Madeline and I have an announcement about fall faith and fellowship. What happened? Oh, okay. Oh, there they are. Okay. People think we're crazy playing cornhole in church, don't they? You know, your dad and I played, I think 2 years in a row, we've been a team at Fall Faith and Fall Faith and Fellowship. And 1 year, we got our clocks cleaned by our friends from Shalot. And last year, we played these two ladies from Topsail. They just about beat us. And one of them was real nice to me. I was playing with her. She was real nice. And, oh, nice shot and everything. And then her partner said, "What are you doing? You're on my team now." And she looked at me and she started trash talking to me the rest of the day. But, ooh, look at there. Are you going to go to Fall Faith and Fellowship?
Yes.
It's at Camp Kirkwood in September. There's going to be a cornhole tournament. I hope your dad's going to be a partner with me. But I heard it's like a youth event. Is that right?
Mm-mm.
It's not just for you?
It's for everybody.
For anybody and everybody? Doesn't matter how old you are?
Mm-hmm.
Good. Well, what about, I see you got your Woodkirk shirt on. You got that last year?
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty cool. Are they going to have Woodkirk again this year?
Yes.
That's on Saturday or Friday night? That's right. Last year was Friday night around the campfire, wasn't it, when we sang and played? And
we sat around the campfire.
Yeah. And you can stay in the cabins or you can stay in the tents too, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's pretty cool. And the first thing that happens on... Oh, look at you. The first thing that happens on Saturday morning is breakfast for those who spent the night. Look at that. Forget you, Roger. I'm going to get Madeline to be my partner. And then there's a worship service, and Jonathan Kelly is going to preach from the Counseling Center. And you know something really cool that's going to happen this year is Miss Hope from Art of Hope, while Jonathan's preaching, she's going to be painting a picture. And that's going to be raffled off. And Miss Nancy's got some tickets that she'd be glad to sell to people. But it's on Saturday, September 12th, and it's just going to be a great time. It's Presbyterians from all over everywhere, and I hope everybody will come.
Mm-hmm.
One thing that's different this year, you know, is everybody's being asked to bring their own lunch, and we're going to provide water and drinks and watermelon. That'll be great, won't it? I think this might be our last time. So, look at there. You think people will go to Fall Faith and Fellowship? I hope so. I know you'll be there. I'm looking forward to it. There you go. Had to end with one in the hole. Thank you, Madeline.
That is going to be a tough act to follow. I was going to, where's Pat? Oh, okay. I was going to start with a little bit about the summer reading program, but I think Pat's going to do what I was going to do. Okay. I have a twofold purpose here. I want to give a shout out to Susan Walters. If you just stand up for a minute. Susan Walters was, some people called her the go-to person, some people called her the brains of the outfit. Her compassion, her caring, and her experience enabled a bunch of amateurs to really have a good experience with a group of kids and really do something in this community for the kids and for the school system. So you're just the best, and we really appreciate it. I couldn't have done it without you. At graduation, the pride of the kids walking up to get their certificates, the parents' pride in seeing their children, knowing that they've done something good for their children. They brought their kids every day, had to find a way to get them there and get them home. And sensing the teachers that the teachers and the staff, that we've done something really good for these students and for our community. And it's in that spirit that I am here today to present us with an opportunity to do something good for the kids in our community this week. Okay. The insert is in the bulletin. It's the only color feature in the bulletin. And it's school supplies for kids. Now, the problem is, when we found out about this, it was last week, so we need to do this week. And the idea is to get school supplies for the kids. Simple stuff, paper, pencils, pens, rulers, 3-ring binders. Who knew? Facial tissue, hand sanitizer, capped erasers, and so forth. There'll be a box in the back of the fellowship hall where you can bring this stuff in. Now, I want to just talk for a minute about that. I came from a church in Connecticut where we had a large endowment, and our cure for everything was to write a check. So if we were having a problem, you just write a check. And we sort of lapsed into feeling that writing a check was what being a good Christian was all about. And I'm not saying that's wrong. In fact, writing a check is definitely part of being a good Christian. In fact, we all might have to step up and be good Christians by writing another check at the end of this budget year. So, okay. But what are you going to get for that check? You're going to get programs like the summer reading program and like Logos and like the Duplin outreach ministries and things like that. That's why we write the check, is for the programs. It's a way to get the ministry out, ministry for us and ministry out into the community. No one who worked in the reading program had to write a check, but we saw the faces of the children, our children of Duplin County. And those faces told us that we, the volunteers, had been good Christians. But checks were written and money was spent to put on the summer reading program. And that program is an outstanding example of the good things that happen because we do write checks. So our faithful stewardship of the abundant resources that God has blessed us with, enabled us to write the checks that make good works like the summer reading program possible, stewardship. So I'm standing here today not to ask you to write a check, but to do some good works to glorify our Father who is in heaven. I'm asking you to please go to Walmart, to Staples, to the dollar store, to Amazon if you can get it delivered this week, and buy some school supplies for our children here in Duplin County who need them badly, because they're not blessed with the resources that we are to go out and buy them for themselves. So take a look now at the insert and pick something that you think can make a difference in a child's learning experience. Pick something that you think, well, kids need this to succeed at school. But don't just write a check. Go out this week, prayerfully and faithfully, spend some of the resources with which God has blessed you and buy that school supply that you know is going to make a difference in a child's life. Bring them to the church this week and place it in the container in the back of the fellowship hall in the back left corner by the ramp there. And then maybe most importantly of all, feel and share the joy that comes with being a faithful Christian steward. Thank you very much.
Well, I'm certainly not going to follow that. I'm just going to ask the summer reading, people in the church who are involved with summer, had something to do with summer reading, please stand up so you can see from this congregation the contribution. Stand up. Thank you very much.
Just very briefly, we begin our fall choir practice schedule this week on Wednesday nights at 7:30. If you are interested and would like to come and be a part of this family and sing with us, we would love to have you. We start Wednesday night and we'll start getting ready for Christmas pretty soon. Please join us for the call to worship.
Good morning. Please join me in reading the opening sentences as they're printed in your bulletin. Oh, what a wonderful God we have. How great are his wisdom and knowledge and riches. How impossible it is for us to understand God's decisions and God's methods. For who among us can know the mind of the Lord? Who knows enough to be the Lord's counselor and guide? For everything comes from God alone. Everything lives by his power, and everything is for his glory. To God be the glory forever. Our first hymn this morning is number 755, Alleluia, Laud and Blessing.
Thank you.
We are the people of God, but Scripture reminds us that we still sin. Let us confess our sin, knowing that the Lord Jesus intercedes for us with the Father, who freely forgives us through his infinite goodness and mercy. Please join me in our unison prayer of confession and our responsive assurance of pardon. Let us pray. Eternal and gracious God, we long to follow you, to walk in the way that you have shown us, to know your commandments, and to practice them wholeheartedly. But we confess that we are easily distracted, lured away by our own interests and desires, enticed by the world around us. Forgive us, Lord. Turn us away from things that distract us from your way, our desire to know you better and follow you more closely. Give us a hunger for your word and your ways. Show us the joy and true life that come from following your will. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Do not worry, the Lord is near. God hears our prayers with compassion and with abundant, steadfast love. Let us rejoice, for in the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Let us sing God's praises for his mercy in our lives. To invite the children to join me on the steps for the children's sermon. Tyler. Hey, Logan. Good morning, all of you. I brought a globe here to show you. It makes it look like the world's not very big, doesn't it? But here's where we live, right there, down near on the coast of North Carolina. And I wanted to show you way over here in Africa, way over here in Zambia, are where some people live that we know, the Ellingtons, who are missionaries, way over here. So look how far that is. Not quite halfway around the world, but pretty close to it. And it takes a long time to get there. I read in the newspaper this week that an airline is now going to have a flight that lasts 17 hours on the airplane. Can you imagine that? That's a long way away, flying about 600 miles an hour. So that's more than half a day on an airplane, and it still didn't get you all the way around the world. So you think of how big this world is. Even though I'm just holding it right there, but think about how big that world is that we live on. Now I brought this book that a friend of mine gave me about space and about God. And look at a picture like that. You know what those are?
A star cluster?
A star cluster, yeah. And you think about that big world, that even if you were on an airplane 17 hours straight, you still wouldn't be able to fly around the whole world, and that big, huge world that we live on is maybe one of those tiny little dots out in space. You ever thought about that? Look at that. Isn't that amazing? Look at that. But that world we live in, the big, big Earth, it's just a tiny little spot in the midst of all those stars and other planets and galaxies. And the reason I brought the globe and the book is to remind us of how big the world is and even how much bigger the universe is, and to remember that God made it all. That God made it all. We can't even make this. We can't even make the Earth, much less everything in it, much less everything in space. And that's just hard to imagine, that God is that powerful and that great and that majestic. The Psalms in the Bible, one of the Psalms says, when I go out and at night and I look up at the stars and I see how big everything is, and I see what you've created, God, it makes me wonder, well, what am I? Who am I that you would even care about me, that you would even know my name? But you do. God knows Tyler and Robert and Hayes and Logan and Lauren and me and everybody, and he loves us so much that he sent his son to die on the cross for us. So I like going out at night and looking at the stars, and I like looking at books like this. And it just is amazing to me to think about how big everything is. But then it also is amazing to me to think that the God who created all of this is the one who loves me and knows my name. Let's have a prayer together. Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you for the wonder of this world. It's hard to imagine how big everything is. But we thank you also that you love us. You know our names and you care about us, and you loved us enough to send your son to die for our sins. That's hard to imagine, that kind of love. But we thank you that you're that kind of God. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you all for coming up.
Come down to the river, come and let yourself in. Make good on a promise and never hurt again. If you're lost and lonely, you're broken down, bring all your troubles, come lay them down. All you sinners and you weak at heart, all of you helpless on the boulevard, wherever you are now, whatever evil you found, bring all of your troubles and come lay on down. We're all tied to the same old failings, finding shelter in things we know. We're all dirty like corrupted small towns. We bring our troubles, we bring our troubles, come lay them down. All you rich men and the high, and without love, all you burdened, you broken down, bring all your troubles, come lay them down, come lay them down, come lay them down, come lay them down.
Please join me in our prayer for illumination in the bulletin as we get ready to read and hear God's word. Let us pray together. Almighty God, in you are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Open our eyes that we may see the wonders of your word. Give us grace that we may clearly understand and freely choose the way of your wisdom. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Our epistle lesson this morning is from Romans chapter 11, verses 33 through 36. Oh, the depth of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God! How unsearchable his judgments and his paths beyond tracing out! Who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been his counselor? Who has ever given to God that God should repay him? For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be the glory forever. Amen. Our next hymn is number 694, Great God of Every Blessing. Please be seated. I invite you to hear the word of God from Psalm 111. Something interesting about Psalm 111 is it goes with Psalm 112. And what I mean by that is it's really a two-part work. I'm just going to read Psalm 111. Psalm 111 is a call to praise the Lord for what God has done for us. And Psalm 112 is a call to praise the Lord in how you live in response to what God has done for you. You cannot see this in the English, but in the Hebrew, these are very well crafted. They're what are called acrostic psalms. Each line begins with the next letter of the Hebrew alphabet. If we were writing it in English, line one would begin with A, line two with B. It's quite a wonderful literary device, probably used to help teach and instruct so that people would remember these psalms. Listen for God's word in Psalm 111. Praise the Lord. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart in the company of the upright in the congregation. Great are the works of the Lord, studied by all who delight in them.
Full of honor and majesty is his work, and his righteousness endures forever. He has gained renown by his wonderful deeds. The Lord is gracious and merciful. He provides food for those who fear him. He is ever mindful of his covenant. He has shown his people the power of his works in giving them the heritage of the nations. The works of his hands are faithful and just. All his precepts are trustworthy. They are established forever and ever to be performed with faithfulness and uprightness. He sent redemption to his people. He has commanded his covenant forever. Holy and awesome is his name. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All those who practice it have a good understanding. His praise endures forever. May God bless the reading and the hearing of his holy word. Let us pray. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. As I've mentioned before, the tagline on my emails has generated many conversations since I began using it a few years ago. At the bottom of my emails, below the contact information, are these words. Ask yourself this question: where is God already at work in this situation? That question came to my attention several years ago in the Pastor Spiritual Guide program, and it has made quite a difference in my life. For one thing, the question slows me down and helps me take stock of whatever is going on around me. Also, the question has helped tamp down a lot of anxiety that might otherwise arise as I remind myself that God is already there at work in whatever situation I'm about to enter into. And finally, the question is a good reminder that God has always been at work, continues to be at work, and will always be at work in our lives and in the world. Last Sunday evening, Reverend Steve Hine led the evening Vesper service by the lake at Camp Kirkwood. Steve is a friend and the pastor of the St. Andrew's Covenant Presbyterian Church in Wilmington. He began the worship service by asking all of us there to look around that beautiful setting and to call out in a word or two something that we saw. Here are some of the responses: calm water, sunlight, God's people at worship, the sun shining through the leaves, dragonflies, green grass, tall trees. Then Steve said, "For all of these things, O God, we give you thanks and praise." And he reminded us that we can pray to God with our eyes wide open and by looking around and noticing how God is at work in the world and in our lives. Steve preached about the providence of God last Sunday night, and he talked about how we usually look back over our lives and say, "Oh, now I see how God was working through those circumstances." Then Steve told us three personal stories that remind him of God's providence. And his point was asking us not just to look back and think about how God was involved, but to look around now and see how God is involved, and to think about how God will be involved in the future. I want to share one of the stories that Steve told us last Sunday night. Steve and members of the St. Andrew's Covenant congregation have made many trips to Brazil to work with a partner congregation. Several years ago, Steve and his wife came to our church to tell us about one of those trips. Last Sunday, Steve told us about getting ready to go on one of those trips. It was the day that they were actually leaving on the plane that a member of the congregation came to Steve and gave him an envelope with some money in it and said, "Here, Steve, take this money and use it however you think best." Steve looked in the envelope and found $1,500. He stuffed the envelope in his back pocket, got on the plane, and flew to Brazil. When they reached their partner church, he and the pastor, who was a friend of his, started having a conversation, and the pastor told Steve that the boat that the church used in their ministry was broken. Steve asked, "What's wrong with the boat?" The pastor said, "It's broken." Steve asked, "What's broken about it?" The pastor said, "One of the parts is broken." Steve asked, "Which part is broken?" The pastor said, "A very important part is broken." Steve kept pressing him, "Can you tell me exactly which part needs to be fixed?" He said the pastor just never, or it took a long time to finally get it out of him. And he said, finally, the pastor told him, "Well, we're praying that the part will be fixed." And Steve asked, "Are you hoping that somehow the part will just miraculously fix itself?" "No," the pastor said, "but we don't have the money to fix it." "How much will it cost to fix the boat?" Steve asked. And now I'm going to ask your help in answering that question, just as Steve asked us last night by the lake. Steve asked, "How much will it cost to fix the boat?" And the pastor said, "To fix the boat, it will cost $1,500. Steve pulled the envelope out and said, "This $1,500. Steve said the pastor could have emailed him, which they did, and told him that the boat was broken and they needed $1,500 to get it fixed, but he didn't do that. Steve said he thought God was reminding him that God is always and already at work in different situations. After the Vesper service, I went up and talked with Steve, and I said, I had the exact same experience in Tabasco, Mexico, back in the 1990s. Before we moved to Wallace, and I was involved in trips down to Villahermosa, Tabasco, Mexico, with the White Memorial Presbyterian Church to help build the Theological Seminary of the Southeast. Three of us went from the church in Roanoke Rapids, Dr. Ricky Watson and Carlton Fanny and I. And right before we left for that trip, some folks in the church handed us an envelope with some money in it and said, "Take this money and use it however you think best." And the amount was $600. After we'd been working on the site, digging foundation holes for a couple of days, a good friend of mine from the White Memorial Presbyterian Church talked to me, and he said he was going around and talking to folks in our group from North Carolina and asking them to contribute some money to help a senior student who owed some seminary fees. And at that school, as at, I guess, all schools, if you didn't pay your expenses, you couldn't graduate and go out and serve a church. I asked Bruce, "Well, how much money are you talking about? How much does he owe?" And Bruce's answer was, "To graduate, he needs $600. And I and the two other members from the church in Roanoke Rapids, one of whom was the church treasurer, that really helped, we put our heads together and we made the easy decision to hand over the $600. We met with that student and the seminary president, and we attached some strings to it. We asked that the $600 be considered a scholarship. And if the graduating student could repay any of the money for others to use in the future, that would be great. But if he couldn't, that was fine. And we would never know. It did not matter. That $600 started a scholarship fund that was ultimately named for that church treasurer who planned to go back to Tabasco the following fall, but who died about 6 weeks before that planned trip. And churches from around the United States started contributing money to that scholarship fund. I think it was a reminder to us. Praise the Lord. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart in the company of the upright in the congregation. Great are the works of the Lord, studied by all who delight in them. Full of honor and majesty is his work, and his righteousness endures forever. He has gained renown by his wonderful deeds, and the Lord is gracious and merciful. And with those uplifting words, the psalmist calls all the people of God, the whole congregation, to worship and praise God for what God has already done in their lives in history. And at the same time, the people worship and remember what God has done for them, and they are reminded of what God is still doing and what God will always be doing through his great works and wonderful deeds. And so what are these great works and wonderful deeds? And the psalmist tells the old, old story of Israel's deliverance at God's mighty hand. That's what this psalm is all about. Praise the Lord for God's wonderful deeds is sort of shorthand. It's kind of code language for the story of Israel's formation as a nation. And you can read that story in Genesis through Joshua. And by many great and wonderful deeds, the gracious and merciful God liberated his people from slavery and made them his own people. The Lord is gracious and merciful. This is how the Lord Yahweh described himself after the people had made themselves a golden calf idol and worshiped it at the base of the mountain as Moses was up receiving the Ten Commandments from God. And God said, "I am gracious and merciful, slow to anger and full of compassion." He provides food for those who fear him. Even though the people grumbled against him and against Moses and wished they were back in Egypt, God gave them quail and manna in the wilderness. In giving them the heritage of the nations, not only did God deliver his people out of bondage, he delivered them into the land of Canaan, just as he had promised Abraham he would. He is ever mindful of his covenant. God said, "I shall be your God, you shall be my people," and that promise is forever, and that promise is for certain. And those are the reasons the psalmist says, "Praise the Lord, I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart in the company of the upright in the congregation." And in the second half of this psalm of praise, the psalmist calls the congregation to worship God in the ongoing covenant relationship. And here are the reasons. Because the works of his hands are faithful and just. All his commandments are trustworthy. They are established forever and ever to be performed with faithfulness and uprightness. He sent redemption to his people. He has commanded his covenant forever. So when we cry out with the psalmist, "Holy and awesome is his name," and when we praise God with the apostle Paul, who said, "Oh, the depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgments, how inscrutable are his ways." When we say those things, we are not worshiping some far off, distant, unapproachable deity. On the contrary, we worship God best by remembering what God has already done for us, by meditating on God's grace and mercy, and by living into that covenant relationship with God that he has made with us as his people, especially through Jesus Christ. Now, over the years, people have given me plenty of reasons why they come to worship God on a Sunday morning. Some people come out of habit. Some people come out of some sense of obligation. Some people say, "I come to get my tank filled up for another week." Some people come to be with friends and neighbors. People come to hear God's word. People come to enjoy beautiful music. There are lots of reasons we come to worship. Psalm 111 suggests that our main motivation for coming to worship God on a Sunday morning, or at any time for that matter, is to remember the marvelous things God has done in our lives and in our history. But we do not come here on Sunday morning just to hear an ancient story as history that has nothing to do with us. But it's as we remember God's deeds in the past that we can focus our attention more carefully on how God is already at work right now in the situations of our lives, even when we have trouble seeing it and believing it. And by remembering the past, we can live in the hope that God will always be at work in our lives and in the world as a gracious, merciful God. So along with the psalmist who wrote Psalm 111 for God's people, I will encourage you also to look back over your life and to discover how God was at work at different times and in different situations, even when at the time you weren't aware that God was at work. But beyond that, I encourage you then to trust that same gracious and merciful God and to believe that He is at work today. And I encourage you to pay attention to what's happening in your life, especially when you're not sure why you're in a particular place at a particular time. And I encourage you, as Steve had us do last Sunday night, to look around and name the things that you say or that you see, and then say, "Thank you, God, for all of these things." Eugene Peterson wrote a devotional book called Praying with the Psalms. And in his reflection on Psalm 111, he writes, "Do we think praise is the natural exuberance of the contented person? It is not. It is the thoughtful response of the redeemed. It springs not from our good feelings, but from God's good acts. We praise God not when we feel good, but when we realize that God is good." And his concluding prayer reads like this: "I will remember and observe your goodness through the hours of this day, O God, keeping in mind what you have done faithfully through centuries of redemption and staying alert to what you presently are doing in the lives of companions in faith, and I will use all I remember and observe to lift praises to you." I first heard Tom Fetke's beautiful song, "The Majesty and Glory of Your Name," at a community Thanksgiving service down the street at First Baptist Church. I think it was the first community Thanksgiving service I attended here. I have this vivid recollection of that combined choir from the different churches there in the choir loft of First Baptist Church, lifting their voices in praise. And I remember being overwhelmed by the wonder of that song and the talent of the choir members and the musicians in this town of Wallace. In a few minutes, Vera is going to play an arrangement of that song, "The Majesty and Glory of Your Name," for the offertory. Just music, no words. But as you listen to that beautiful music, I'd like for you to think about what God has already done for us, what God continues to do for us, and what God has promised to do for us. And as you listen to the music, think about these words from the song, words which echo Psalm 111 and which call us to praise the Lord with our whole heart. Some of the words to the song: "O Lord our God, the majesty and glory of your name transcends the earth and fills the heavens. O Lord our God, little children praise you perfectly, and so would we, and so would we. Alleluia, alleluia, the majesty and glory of your name." Let us pray. Almighty God, give us such a vision of your purpose and will, and such an assurance of your love and power, that we may hold fast to the hope which is in Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. In our prayers this week, let us pray for Mary Ayers. Mary is going to have knee replacement surgery on Wednesday at the hospital in Chapel Hill. Let us continue to lift up Ed Rector, Lydia Woodard's father, who's recovering from a stroke, still in the rehab center in Kenansville, but Lee said this morning, talking about coming home. So pray for Mr. and Mrs. Rector. I'd like to ask you to pray for the elders and me as the session meets on Tuesday night of this week. And also again, this week, let us pray for our teachers who go back to school, for administration and staff, and for students who will be going back soon, and for those who are already back in school, those who are in year-round school, and also for our college students, who most of whom are heading back right now. Let us pray together. Oh Lord, your name is majestic in all the world. When we look at the stars, the heavens, the world around us, sometimes we do wonder who we are, what we are, why you care about us. And yet, the Psalms tell us you call us by name. You have created us for a purpose. And the Gospels tell us that you loved us enough to send your Son to die for our sins and to give us new life. And so with Paul, we do say, how unsearchable are your ways. To you be all glory forever and ever, O God. Lord, we pray for Mary this week as she has knee replacement surgery. We thank you for that technology. We thank you for her doctor's skills. We pray that this surgery will relieve her of her pain and help her. We pray that you'll be with Clint and with Jean as they help Mary in her rehab and her recovery. Lord, we thank you that Mr. Rector is making progress after this stroke. We pray for his wife, for his family, and we do pray that he continue to be better and be able to come home soon. We give you thanks and glory for that. Lord, we pray for the students who will be going back to school. We pray for teachers who are getting their classrooms ready and anticipating another year. We pray for our administrators who are looking after so many details, getting ready for the opening of school. Lord, we pray for students who are already in school and year-round school and their teachers. Lord, be with all of them as they have a good year, a safe year, a year full of learning and joy. We pray for our college students heading back to campus, moving in. Pray for those who are going for the first time as freshmen. Lord, be with them, give them confidence, help them adjust. And Lord, be with the families of all these college students as we send them off with our best wishes and our love. Lord, we thank you for the ministries we've heard about here today. We thank you for the reading program that we were able to provide this year. We pray for those students as they begin school. We pray that what they learned here will make a difference in their lives. We thank you for the blessing they brought to this place and to our lives each day. Lord, help us to be faithful to you in all that we do. Help us to remember your faithfulness always. Help us to remember and see how you have been in our lives. Help us to open our eyes today to look around and to recognize your grace and mercy at work, and help us to live into the relationship you have established through Jesus Christ our Lord. We pray all these things in his name as we pray together the prayer that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let us continue to worship God as we present our tithes and our offerings. Let us pray. Loving God, you are never far from us. You are as close as our breathing. We recognize you as the one who heals the wounded spirit and gives new life to the brokenhearted. Oh God, we offer these gifts to you as a sign of our commitment to your grace and authority. Take us and use us in all that we have so that the kingdom of heaven may be realized here on earth through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us affirm our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 30. Now to him who is able to keep you from falling and to make you stand without blemish in the presence of his glory with rejoicing, to the only God our Savior through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, power, and honor from this time forth and forevermore. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you.